Most episodes of the A&E show Hoarders are inherently heartbreaking because viewers get to look into the grim reality of people living with a hoarding disorder. Even though the point of the show is to help, there are certainly some episodes that have had seriously tragic endings. Terry, who was featured in Season 6, Episode 8, may have started hoarding after witnessing the death of her father as a child, according to her son. But animal lovers should be warned. Her hoarding, one of the most disturbing collections on Hoarders, was turned toward cats instead of possessions. Fans of the show are used to seeing shocking things, but this episode showed Terry keeping the bodies of around 100 cats in her freezer and other parts of her home. She had 50 living cats at the time of filming. Of those cats, the specialists and team called in only managed to save 18. They had to euthanize the rest due to upper respiratory infections, one of the animal control specialists explained during the cleanup. During the episode, Terry said that she hoarded cats as a way to, quote, save something. This sad reality is common enough within hoarding that the show Confessions Animal Hoarding was created and aired on Animal Planet. While various news stations have reported that persons who hoarded hundreds of cats who did not appear on Hoarders were charged with animal cruelty, Terry was never charged. Season 8, Episode 8 of Hoarders featured a couple, Ed and Connie, obsessed with Halloween, who filled their home with all kinds of frightening and festive decorations. However, it wasn't their home that scared viewers, it was Peggy's, who was also featured in the episode. The city had seen Peggy's home and decided it was not safe to live in, and after the episode first aired, viewers reportedly began placing calls to the Pekin Police Department about the dead animals displayed on the program. According to the Washington Times reporter, Pekin Code Enforcement Officer and building inspector Ron Z saw the home and participated in the program without alerting police. Later, an internal investigation led to his resignation. Peggy, whose real name is Cora Belk, was charged with a misdemeanor and fined, as reported by the Pekin Daily Times. Sandra Cowart, who appeared in Season 9 of Hoarders, had a huge mansion consisting of a whopping 31 rooms, and she had filled the entire space with clutter and junk. The home, known as the Julian Price Home, is featured on the National Register of Historic Places, as well as the Guilford County Landmark Properties List. Though she owned the Tudor-style home for 40 years, the bank foreclosed on it. Sandra told the court during the foreclosure process that she was working 18-hour days to try to get out of debt, but she was 67 months past due on her loan. She impressively fought the various foreclosures for years and lives there optimistically believing she can turn the tables back in her favor, as she said in the episode.
My goal is to have the legal system invalidate the foreclosure.
When the home was sold, it still had trash, mold, and large furniture items that needed to be removed, and that responsibility fell on the new owners. They bought the place as it is, where it is, which was quite the unique situation. Michael, one of the new owners, explained in an interview with WFMY News 2 that he not only wanted to get the house back in shape, but help Sandra as well. Since she had refused to leave the house after it was foreclosed on, Michael had an idea. Not knowing much about the mental illness itself, he reached out to Hoarders to see if they could help. Fortunately, they fixed it up so well that people can now stay in the home, and many Hoarders fans follow along with the mansion's journey on the successful Instagram account that has more than 18,000 followers. What makes this a tragic Hoarder story is obviously the fact that Sandra lost her home, but also the sad truth that she used to be a very successful interior designer. In the 90s, Sandra would host guests during the annual International Home Furnishings Market who wanted to stay in her historic home, as the Chicago Tribune shared. One of the main concerns experts have with massive cleanouts in a short period of time is the idea that the people who are forced to throw everything out quickly will go back to hoarding. That sadly appeared to be what happened when it came to Betty from Season 1, Episode 3. Fans of the show might remember that her tragic hoarding led to her husband Charles being removed from the home by Adult Protective Services. It was an incredibly emotional event for the family, especially Betty's children. She had to clean the space in order for him to have a chance to come home. Betty and Charles had been staying at a motel for multiple months, though that was clearly not a long-term answer to their problems. Both expressed that they were running out of money and needed to find a better solution. Betty was known for being one of the more difficult hoarders that Dorothy Breninger dealt with. In a follow-up episode, Betty noted that the attention from neighbors impacted her negatively, and she said that she should put a sign in front that read, "Driving by and gawking $1 to charge people to look at her now famous home." Only one of the people featured in the follow-up episode was successful successful in continuing to recover from hoarding, and it wasn't Betty. By the end of the update episode, Betty was estranged from her family, and she admitted she went back to hoarding a month after the show ended. Hoarders Season 11 featured Carol, who surprised viewers and expert organizer Dorothy Breninger with her cold behavior and attitude toward her husband Dave. He'd previously shared the house with his late first wife. In the episode, we saw that the entire home, including the stairwell, was filled with Carol's possessions to the point that Dave only had a small space to sit on a couch with his oxygen tank. Some fans expressed that Dave would be better off getting a divorce and removing Carol from his home.
I don't want to look at anybody right now.
Okay.
I'm tired of it.
Though Dave's children and Carol fought throughout the episode, Dr. David Tolan expressed, "Maybe this house can be what pulls this family back together." By the end of the episode, it seemed like the family was on the path to healing, but sadly, it was revealed that Dave had passed away and no one in the family was speaking to Carol. Fans of Hoarders will remember that Jill hoarded food far past its expiration date, and her refrigerator got so bad that any food that was put in her fridge became contaminated. The first time we saw Jill, she had, among other messes, a pumpkin rotting in her living room. The AV Club guessed that when she grabbed some seeds from the puddle of pumpkin during the episode, it might have been to plant more. In the same follow-up episode that featured Betty, fans saw that Jill had unfortunately gone back to hoarding food. When the crew came back after the initial filming for the update episode, fans saw that Jill had expired food in the fridge again. When they walked into her living room, she had a rotting pumpkin on the table, and she laughed about it being 2 years old. This is all especially tragic because Jill started hoarding food because she was raised poor and struggled with her finances while raising her children. Glenn Brittner from Season 3, Episode 20 of Hoarders was known for his heartbreaking story. He had rats as pets before losing his wife, but he eventually lost control over up to 2,500 critters. What made matters more complicated, psychologist Dr. Robin Zazio noted that Glenn saw the rats as his children. One Reddit user explained that out of all the episodes, Glenn's touched them the most because of how much emotional pain he was clearly in. He was a kind man, and the Los Angeles Times revealed that it might have been his open heart that led to his death. KTLA 5 reported that he was using a wheelchair at the time of his death, and he was found tied up with zip ties and his head was bleeding from a large wound. According to the Los Angeles Times, police never found signs of forced entry, but items were taken from the home, which led them to believe his kindness was taken advantage of. The case still hasn't been solved, despite pleas from the family on the third anniversary of his death in 2018, according to the Antelope Valley Times. Ray and Tony were two elderly brothers living together. In their Hoarders episode, Ray shared that his San Francisco home would be worth around $2 million. That's if it wasn't filled to the brim with Ray's hoard. Ray is seen happily walking around town with a smile on his face, chatting with neighbors. That is, until it was time to come back to his home, where he had to climb over piles of clothes and stuff and was barely able to open the door. The pair of brothers went on the show because Ray's hoard caused the home to catch fire, and it could have burned down the neighbor's home as well. The tragedy of this hoarder's story is that when Tony tragically passed away, Ray shared that he didn't get time to grieve because he had to power through with the cleanup in order to not lose his home.
Tony would be amazed, Tony would be happy. He'd give the yippee-ta-yay woo-hoo louder and more joyously than I.
While most Hoarders episodes feature two hoarders, this case was so intense that they only featured Augustine's story. Augustine's son, Jason, had been removed from her care as a child due to her hoarding, and Child Protective Services never cleared him to return to the home. He wasn't even living in the same state, but he still came back to help his mother with the process of clearing out her home. In the episode, Jason thanked his mother for nurturing his passion for nature and supporting his interests as a child. Despite everything he went through as a child because of his mother, he still had kind words to say to her. Tragically, not even the chance to save their relationship could keep Augustine from hoarding, as fans saw on the Hoarders Where Are They Now special. At the beginning of the episode, Augustine admitted that she hadn't really been trying that hard to keep the house clean. At the end of her section of the follow-up, it was revealed that Jason hadn't come back since the cleanup and wasn't planning to. In 2010, he shared a rather sad note on Facebook that detailed how growing up in that house impacted him as a kid and said that he was picked on in school because of his mother's hoarding. Viewers might remember the episode with married couple Dennis and Nadine from Season 2 of Hoarders. Dennis was so depressed about the house that he had expressed to his daughter that he wanted to take his own life, and she was worried. Nadine also said he had threatened to kill her, and his daughter feared he might snap. The house got so bad that Adult Protective Services became involved and Dennis stopped leaving his bedroom, which was full of his collection of weapons. When the crew returned, Dennis was still in bed and had lost weight due to his depression after his gun collection was removed. When Nadine and Dr. Zazio went into the kitchen, Nadine admitted that the mess had gotten worse because she didn't like doing the dishes. But the home wasn't just messy. There was a bag of old hamburger meat on the ground. Dennis ultimately shared that he felt the house was going back to the way it was. If you or anyone you know is having suicidal thoughts, please call the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline at 1-800-273-TALK-8255.